Shree Sai Satcharitra, Chapter 11, The Description of Shree Sai's Greatness. I bow down to Shree Ganesh, I bow down to Shree Saraswati, I bow down to the Guru, I bow down to the Family Deity, I bow down to Shree Sita Ramachandra, I bow down to Shree Sadguru Sainath. This is the continuation of the previous narration. Baba sleeping on a narrow plank, his climbing up and descending, which was inconceivable and difficult to describe. Whether a Hindu or a Muslim, he behaved equally towards both. This became the mission of his life. Such was he, the Lord, who was worshipped in Shirdi. Now this 11th chapter, consisting of the delightful story of the life of the Guru, I have thought of offering at the feet of Sai with utmost devotion. By this you will be able to meditate on the manifested form, know how he was worshipped, and his control over the five elements. Baba's greatness will thus be understood. O listeners, please pay attention how Indra, Agni and Varun obeyed Baba's commands. I shall now narrate that. Let us remember him with love. He was the personification of non-attachment. Such was his manifested form. He was the refuge of numerous devotees. Honor the words of the Guru and give him a seat in your heart with faith. With complete resolution and abandoning all aspirations, let us worship him with only this desire. Guru Raj is even greater than all the seven images of God: sacrificial altar, fire, supreme light, sun, water, Brahman, those wearing the sacred thread. Let us single-mindedly worship him. The devotees of the Guru experience, on resorting to his feet with full faith, that not only Guru but Parabrahma is moved. Such is the marvel of Guru Puja. As long as the worshipper has a form, then it is essential that the Guru also has a bodily form. For the formless abstract energy, no bodily form is required. This is what even the Shastras emphasize. Unless and until one worships the bodily form, true devotion does not spring forth. And till there is no such devotion, full of love, the inner mind does not blossom. Unless that blossoms, only the lotus bud does not have either the fragrance or the honey. You will see that even the bee will not pause there for a moment. That which has attributes, sattva, rajas, tamas, is with form. That which has no attributes is without form. Both are not different from each other. The formless and the one with the form are one. Though frozen, it is ghee only, and when it melts, it is also called ghee. The concrete and abstract are one and the same, and the abstract is spread in the form of the universe. Whosoever can feast one's eyes on whose feet one can rest one's head, on whom one can meditate suitably, love develops there. In whose company one can chat lovingly, and who can be worshipped with sandalwood paste and rice, colored with turmeric and kumkum, for that a form is a necessity. It is really easy to understand the nature of a bodily form rather than the formless. Once love for the Saguna increases, it is the awakening for the formless abstract. Baba would evolve various means to enable the devotees to experience the abstract. By his authority, he would make them sit far and forbid darshan for a long time. One would be sent on tour, one would be isolated in Shirdi, one would be confined to the Vada and made to read the Pothi regularly. When such a studious training is undergone for a number of years together, then the craving for the abstract will develop. While resting, sleeping and eating, one would then enjoy Baba's company mentally. The body is perishable, certainly. It is going to come to an end at some point of time. Therefore, the devotees should not feel distressed, but should concentrate on the eternal. This manifold perceivable world is the manifestation of the unknown or invisible. It has taken shape or form from the invisible and will return to the invisible. The universe, which has evolved from the Brahman, with each part having the same divine essence as the whole, will also be assimilated with the invisible form from where it has taken birth. Therefore, no being dies. Then how can there be death for Baba? Shree Sai is always pure, enlightened, perfect, and untouched by death. Some may call him a devotee of God, some may call him a great soul, but for us he is truly the very embodiment of the Lord. The Ganga flows to meet the ocean, and on the way she cools those who are distressed by the oppressive heat. The Ganga flows to meet the ocean, and on the way she cools those who are distressed by the oppressive heat, gives life to the trees on the banks, and quenches everyone's thirst. Similar is the manifestation of the saints. They appear and disappear, but their behavior purifies the world. Of an extremely forgiving temperament, soft-spoken, gentle, tolerant, and also incomparably contented, outwardly, though possessing a form, yet he is without a form, without qualities of passion. He is without attachments, and within him he is liberated, though he lives an ordinary life. Krishna, who is himself God, says, "A saint is, as it were, my soul, my living image, and a saint is my beloved and is myself." It is not befitting to call saints as my images. Saints are undoubtedly my own self. Therefore, for their sake, I shoulder the burdens of the devotees. One who completely surrenders to the saints, I also bow down to his feet. So said Shri Krishna to Uddhava while describing the greatness of the saints. One who is the most virtuous amongst the virtuous, the one without a form amongst the formless, the one who excels amongst those endowed with excellence, he is the king of virtuosity amongst the virtuous. One who is completely satisfied by having fulfilled one's mission, one who is contented because his desires are fulfilled, one who is engrossed in the self and is beyond pleasures and pain, one who is the glorious form of inner bliss, who can describe that greatness? It is truly indescribable. He is the incarnation of Brahman, or is it this indescribable power which has manifested itself on this earth, the incarnation of the Satchidananda? He is the treasure of knowledge, one who is absolute Brahman in every respect, one who is detached from all mundane existence, permanently non-attached, in a state of oneness with Brahman, and incarnation of bliss. Brahman is bliss, the Shrutis say. Listeners have heard this often. The learned read this in the scriptures. The devotees experience this in Shirdi. This world is utterly unique. It has both the righteous and the wicked elements. Those who do not have the knowledge of the self need to be protected from such a world at every moment. But this is not a problem for those who are self-realized. They have a refuge in their inner self. They are always liberated, full of bliss, and engrossed in the Supreme Being. Baba is the abiding abode of all. Why would he need a seat? That also a silver one. But it is only because of Baba's devotees' desires. For a long time, there was an old seat, which was a piece of sackcloth. On that, the loving devotees had put a nice mattress for him to sit. Against the wall behind, on which he rested, the devotees put a bolster. Baba abided by the devotees' wishes. Though his residence appeared to be in Shirdi, he was all-pervasive. This was always experienced by his devotees, by Sai's powers. Though immutable, he accepted the worship and honors, that is rituals, according to the faith of the devotees. He accepted the devotion in all the different ways. Some waved the whisks, some fanned, some played shehnai or drums and auspicious musical instruments, and some offered puja. Some would lave his hands and feet to drink the water as tirtha. Some anointed him with attar and sandalwood paste. Some offered him betel nuts made out of 13 ingredients. Some offered Mahanivedya. Some applied Gandha paste with two fingers horizontally across the forehead, as it is done for Shivalinga, without a break. Some applied Kasturi mixed with perfume, and also applied sandalwood. On one occasion, Tatya Sahib Nulkar's friend by the name Dr. Pandit came to Shirdi only once to take Sai Baba's darshan. No sooner than he arrived at Shirdi, he went first to the masjid and, after doing obeisance to Baba, sat quietly there for a moment. Baba then said to him, "Go to Dada Bhatt's. Go this way," showing the way with the fingers of his hand. Pandit went to Dada's. Dada gave him a suitable welcome. Then, when Dada set out for Baba's worship, he asked him if he would come along. Pandit accompanied Dada. Dada worshipped Baba. Till then, no one had dared to apply fragrant paste, that is Gandha Tilak, circular auspicious mark on the forehead, to Baba. Whosoever may be the devotee, he would not allow him to apply the fragrant paste to his forehead. Only Mahasapati smeared it on his throat. Others applied it to his feet. But this Pandit was simple and full of devotion. He took away Dada's puja thali and, holding Shri Sai's head, he anointed him with the three-fingered parallel lines, Tripundra. Seeing his daring, Dada's heart began to beat hard. He thought that Baba would be enraged. What a rash act this was. Thus, the impossible had happened. Baba did not utter a word. On the contrary, he seemed quite pleased and did not get angry with him at all. So be it. He let that moment pass, but Dada felt a disquietude. Then, that same day's end, he asked Baba about it. "When we try to apply a small tilak of paste to your forehead, you do not allow us to touch your forehead. But what happened this morning? You dislike our tilak, yet Pandit's Tripundra was found favorable. Why this unusual behavior? There seems to be some inconsistency." Then, very lovingly, Sai smiled and spoke to Dada. "Listen to that sweet remark with devotion, all of you. Dada, his guru is a Brahmin. I am by caste a Musliman, but believing me to be his guru, he did guru puja. I am a great pious Brahmin. He is an unholy Yavan, that is Muslim. How should he be worshipped? He had no such doubts. This is how he ensnared me. There, I had no alternative. There was no room to raise any objection. He overwhelmed me." Though such a reply was heard, Dada took it lightly. But the essence was realized when Dada returned home. This inconsistency of Baba greatly hurt Dada. But while talking to Pandit, his doubts were immediately clarified. Pandit was enjoined to the feet of Raghunath, a sage from Dhubeshwar, well known as Karka Puranik. The deep relationship was that of a disciple. He invoked Kaka. He experienced such a feeling that Baba was one with Kaka. As per one's faith, devotion is rewarded. So be it. He would get all the rituals done if only he so desired. Otherwise, he would throw away the puja thalis and he would become Narsingha incarnate, display wrath. When he displayed this nature, who would be so courageous as to withstand it? Everyone would run for their lives when he was furious. Suddenly, at times, he is furious and full of fire and brimstone with his devotees. Sometimes he is softer than wax, the image of peace and forgiveness. At times he resembles an erupted volcano, fire at the time of destruction, and would keep the devotees at the razor's edge, hold them in mortal fear. At times he is softer than butter and shines with bliss. Even if he trembles with rage and rolls his eyes round and round, but Within his heart there is a spring of kindness, like a mother's towards her child. Within a moment, when he resumes his normal behavior after his anger subsides, he will call his devotees by name and say, "When I get angry with anyone, I am not aware of it." If a mother kicks her child or the ocean rolls back the water of the rivers, then only would I scornfully neglect you and would harm you. I am under my devotees' obligations. I am always beside them, standing close. I am always hungry for love. I am at their beck and call. In the course of writing this part of the narration, I am reminded of an apt story, which is exemplary. Listen to it with respect. Once, a Muslim resident of Kalyan by the name of Siddiq Phalke, after a pilgrimage to Makkah Madina, arrived at Shirdi. That old Haji stayed in the Saudi facing the north. For the first 9 months, Baba was displeased with him and was not ready to meet him. The auspicious hour did not come for him. His wearisome trips were futile, that is, between the North Saudi and the Masjid. He tried different ways and means, but could never exchange glances with Baba. The Masjid was always open to everyone. No one was debarred or prohibited, but Phalke had no permission to mount the steps of the Masjid. Phalke became internally dejected. "What kind of karmas have been instrumental that my steps cannot enter the Masjid? What sins have I committed? By what turn of events will Baba be propitious towards me and come forward towards me?" That was the sole thought day and night in Phalke's mind, like the throbbing of his own heart. In the meanwhile, somebody advised him not to be dejected like this. "Take Madhav Rao's help and your heart's desire will be fulfilled. Before taking Nandi's darshan, can Shankar become propitious?" He approved of following this method and liked the idea of using this means. On the face of it, the listeners will think this to be an exaggeration, but this was the experience in Shirdi at the time of darshan. Whoever desired to be with Baba without any disturbance, to have a dialogue, he was required to go with Madhav Rao at the outset. Who has come, from where and wherefore, for the purpose of telling all this in a sweet and suitable manner, and to introduce Madhav Rao was required. Then Samartha became willing to talk. The Haji heard all this and persuaded Madhav Rao. He said, "Once at least dispel my turmoil. Help me to attain the unattainable." With this pressure on Madhav Rao to find a suitable opportunity, he made a firm decision. Whether the task was difficult or not, he would make an effort. He plucked up courage and went to Masjid. He broached the subject very delicately. "Baba, that old man is greatly distressed. Please oblige him. That Haji has come to Shirdi for your darshan after doing the Makkah Madina pilgrimage. How can you not be merciful to him and not allow him to come into the Masjid? Innumerable persons come, freely enter the Masjid, take darshan and leave quickly. Why is only this one lingering in vain? Be merciful towards him just once. Meet him in the Masjid. Then he will also leave quickly after asking the question in his heart. Shama, the infant spume has not yet even dried on your lips. If Allah's grace is not with him, what can I do for him? If he does not have an indebtedness of Allamiya, can anyone climb the steps of the Masjid? The fakir's actions are beyond understanding, and I have no control over them. So be it. There is a narrow footpath beyond the Barwi well. Go and ask him clearly if he will walk and come there correctly." The Haji said, "However difficult it may be, I will walk correctly, but grant me a personal meeting and let me sit near his feet." Listening to the answer from Sharma, Baba said, "Ask him further, 4 times 40,000 rupees will you give to me? When Madhavrao gave him his message, the Haji said, what are you asking? If he asks, I will give 40 lakhs. Wherein lies the question of thousands? Listening to this answer, Baba said, ask him, today we have a desire to slaughter a goat in our masjid. What part of the meat do you wish? Would he like bones with flesh, haunch or testicles? Go and ask that old man what he definitely wants. Madhavrao related in detail to the Haji whatever Baba had said. Haji emphatically said, I need nothing of all that. Give me whatever he wishes, but I have only one desire. If I only get a morsel from the Golamba, I will have attained my object and my well-being. Madhavrao returned with this response from the Haji. While he was presenting this statement, Baba became wild with anger immediately. Picking up the Golamba and the water pot in his own hands, he threw them out of the door. Biting his hand noisily, he came near the Haji, holding his kafani with both hands and lifting it up. He stood in front of the Haji and said, what do you think yourself to be? Are you boasting in front of me? You are giving yourself airs because of your age. Is that the way you recite the Quran? You are vain because you have done the pilgrimage to Makkah, but you do not realize who I am. In this manner, he was reproached using unspeakable words. The Haji was dumbfounded. Baba then turned back. While entering the courtyard of the masjid, he saw the gardener's wife selling mangoes. He purchased all the baskets and sent them immediately to the Haji. In the same way, he turned back immediately and went again towards that Haji. He took out rupees 55 from the pocket and counted them on Haji's hands. Thereafter, there developed affection. The Haji was invited to eat, and both of them forgot all the past. The Haji was delightfully blissful. Then he left and frequently came again. He took full pleasure in Baba's affection. Then Baba gave him gifts of monies from time to time. May that be whatsoever. Once I was astounded to see Sai Samartha exercise his authority over the clouds and saw him praying to Indra. It was a very frightful time. The entire sky was black and overcast. Birds and beasts were frightened. A hurricane-like wind began to blow. The sunset, and it was evening. Suddenly, the whirlwind arose. Strong gusty winds blew. There was an irresistible commotion, accompanied by peals of thunder, crackling of lightning, shrieking winds, and torrential rains. It rained cats and dogs. Hailstones noisily descended. The village folk and the cattle had a fearful anticipation and cried and bellowed, creating a loud commotion. Destitute beggars came for shelter under the eaves of the masjid and were joined by the cattle and calves. The masjid was crowded. There was water in all the quarters. The hay was completely washed away. The harvest was totally wet in the threshing ground. People were struck aghast. The whole village was frightened and worried. They came in and filled the courtyard of the masjid, and some stayed under the eaves. They put forth their grievance to Baba. Shirdi abounded in temples of Zogai, Zakhai, Mariai, Shani, Shankar, Ambabai, Maruti, Khandoba, Mahasai. Yet, at any critical juncture, no one was of any service to the villagers except the one and only prompt and quick Sai, who helped in all difficulties. He did not need sacrifices of goats and cocks, nor offerings of money. All that he desired was true devotion to sweep away all difficulties. Maharaj was greatly moved by seeing the panic of the people. He left his seat and came forward and stood near the plinth of the masjid. The sky was reverberating with the sound of thunder, and a cracking lightning set the sky ablaze with light. In the midst of all this stood Maharaj, shouting at the top of his voice, "Gods love their devotees and their saints and sages more than themselves. Gods heed their words and take human birth for their sake. Gods have to espouse the cause of the devotees on hearing their appeals. They uphold all the requests as soon as they are made, recalling the faith of the devotees." Loud bawls followed one after another, resounding in the sky. The masjid seemed to shake. Everyone was deafened. The masjid and the temples resounded with earth-shaking voice. Then the clouds stopped their own thunder and even the rains stopped pouring. Baba's loud bawling was so profuse that the whole courtyard full of people got rooted to the spot, whispering amongst itself. Baba's skill and powers were inconceivable. It had an effect on the rains. The wind also was immediately controlled, and the darkness caused by the fog was dissipated. Slowly, the rain decreased. The wind also lessened. The constellations became visible. The darkness was dispelled by that time. Later, the rains stopped completely. The gale winds quietened. The moon appeared in the sky. Everyone was cheered. Indra melted at the plight and upheld the words of the saint. The clouds were dispersed in all directions. The whirlwind calmed down. The rains totally abated. The wind blew gently. The sound of thunder subsided. The birds and beasts regained their courage. Leaving the shelter of their eaves, the cattle and calves came out and roamed again without fear. The birds also flew into the sky. Having earlier experienced the terrifying incident, all the people returned to their homes after expressing their gratitude to Baba. The cattle also peacefully dispersed. Such was Sai, the embodiment of mercy. He had great love for the devotees. His concern was like that of a mother for the children. How can I describe that loving nature? Similarly, he had control over the fire. Listeners, please listen with respect to a short story as an example. You will realize the unexcelled power. One afternoon, the dhuni blazed uncontrollably. The flames billowed. Who could stay near it? The flames of the fire increased fiercely and reached the roof of wooden beams. It appeared that the masjid would quickly be burnt to ashes, as at the burning of Holi. Nevertheless, Baba was composed while all the people became apprehensive. All the people were amazed at the reunion Baba was facing. One asked, "Shall we bring some water?" Another said, "Who will pour on it? Who will go near there to receive the blow of the satka on the head?" Though everybody was restless, none had the courage to ask. At that moment, Baba made a movement and placed his hand on the satka. Seeing the blazing flames, he took the satka in his hand and started forcefully striking blow after blow, saying, "Get back." An arm's length from the dhuni, he was forcefully striking the pillar while looking at the flames and saying, "Calm down, calm down." With every stroke, the flames lessened and subsided. The dhuni became calm and the fear disappeared completely. Such was Sai, the doyen of the saints, God incarnate. On placing your head at his feet, he will lay the boon-giving hand on your head. Whosoever reads this chapter regularly with faith and devotion, all the problems will be resolved after the completion of the reading with concentration. What more can I say? After purifying the mind, scrupulously do the Sai Parayan. you will attain eternal Brahman. Attain the unattainable, ultimately become desireless. Attain the difficult fourfold mukti and uninterrupted peace. So be it. Those devotees who desire to enjoy the bliss of Paramartha and perfect knowledge should read this chapter repeatedly with great respect. The minds will be purified, savoring the stories will develop an attitude of spiritual inclinations. They will attain whatever is desired, and whatever is not auspicious or desirable will be destroyed. Personally experience Baba. Hemadpant surrenders to Sai. The next chapter is very scary. The next chapter is very sacred, about the relationship of the Guru and the disciple. Darshan of Gholap by the Guru Putra. No matter what the circumstances, the disciple should never abandon his own Gurudev. Sai gave specific experiences of this and increased the firm faith. Those devotees who came and surrendered each had the unique darshan in different forms of deities and our gurus, and their faith was confirmed. May there be well-being. This is the end of the 11th chapter of Shree Sai Samartha Satcharitra, written by the devotee Hemadpant, impelled by saints and virtuous people, called The Description of Shree Sai's Greatness. This is offered to Shree Sadguru Sainath. May there be auspiciousness.